I wanted to start by taking a look at the world today, but first I wanted to just get a round of applause for everybody here, because you guys are here to challenge the status quo, and I think that's just phenomenal. So round of applause for yourselves. Okay, so I want to look at the world today quickly from the standpoint of big brands, innovators, retailers, and the consumer. Just take a quick look just to level set where we are today and what our starting point is. Big brands, I feel so badly for you guys, and I never thought I'd say that. You guys are getting squeezed from every single angle out there. You're getting squeezed by the retailers, your factories, your investors. You may be tied up in either an acquisition, being acquired and put into a new company, or acquiring somebody else and doing the onboarding for them. You're getting squeezed by material suppliers. You're getting squeezed by your freight forwarders. You're getting squeezed more by your retailers again. And then there's the consumer, who's also putting on pretty hardcore squeeze nowadays. You're even getting squeezed by your own employees. So you probably feel in this model today that something's got to give, because there's just no more left to give and there's not enough time in the day. For the startups and innovators here, you guys are the guys that I'm in awe of. And you're doing the coolest things, but when it comes to bringing the products out into the market, there's a big challenge today. And the challenge is that retailers talk about being a fast follow in most cases. Certainly not every retailer, but in most cases, the retailer is really demanding that you're the one to create the demand for the product. They're also telling you beyond that, once you create the demand for the product, they'll be willing to try it, but if it doesn't work, they're going to shift all the risk back to you. So you may feel like your only possibility, or the most sane possibility, is taking a direct-to-consumer approach, so that you're really in control of the process, soup to nuts. The consumer. Consumer. So when I started in retail, I always heard about customer loyalty and consumer loyalty. And people talked about consumer loyalty, and that customer loyalty was loyalty to either a retailer or a brand. Today, the customer is more loyal than ever. The challenge for us is that loyalty has shifted to a loyalty to themselves, to what's most precious to them. It's loyalty to their wallet, their time, their convenience, and it's shifting the way that retail is playing out today. And it's not necessarily a bad thing, it just sets a new standard for how we need to play, and I think we've developed some rules that I'll get into in a little while that will help you manage that shift in the consumer behavior. Last one that I want to talk about is the retailer today. This is another place where I think the retailers have undergone so much consolidation and there's so much lack of differentiation out in the marketplace that it's created almost an obsession with price. And retailers spend months and months planning for Black Friday. But if we kind of break this down and look at what the retailer's saying to the consumer, take a heritage retailer like Macy's, and not to pick on them, I worked there for most of my career, so I figured I could take a little bit more liberty with it. They're saying to their best customer, leave your family at Thanksgiving dinner because we've got some great deals for you. So leave your family on Thanksgiving dinner, line up in front of the stores so that you get a good spot when we open and you can make that mad dash into the store. Risk your safety and then buy something cheap. And we're going to give it to you at an amazing price, free. But free is not really free. We're going to give you a little bit of an assignment. We're going to give you some homework in order to get this. So you can spend the money to get it. We'll give you the money back if you go through the process of cutting out the UPC, filling out the form. And oh, by the way, it feels really great to give a gift to somebody once you've cut the UPC off the box. So the question is this the way we want to treat our best customers in retail? And it's no wonder that the consumer is becoming more loyal to themselves. If the picture doesn't help you answer this question, I put together a little montage that I hope will get you closer to the answer that I'm looking for.
So this is Christmas.
I'm always speechless when I see a video like that and how that's become kind of this badge of honor on how we do merchandising today. And that's what we spend so much time focusing on. And I'm so excited to be here today because I feel like this group and this event is putting the focus onto what's going to change our retail world and the consumer product world in housewares from this type of focus to really a focus on product. So just a little bit about my background. I am celebrating my 25th anniversary of entering the retail world, my professional job, my first job, where I went into Lord & Taylor as an executive trainee. I was a kid out of college and started to learn about retail. When I started at Lord & Taylor, there were over 100 department store companies in America. I mean, it's amazing to think that less than three decades ago, there were over 100 department store companies in America. And I made my way through Lord & Taylor training program, became a buyer of men's tailored clothing, made the move to Macy's, where I thought that I landed in the center of the retail world. At the time, I think I may have, but it certainly had the blinders on to a lot of what was going on in retail. I had a great experience because I got to work in just about every type of business in the company and every product category. And what was interesting and eye-opening to me, particularly recently, is I started as a men's suit buyer. And was a men's suit buyer when Casual Friday was becoming big, so my business was the worst in the company. And when you look at men's tailored clothing or men's suits, for the most part, the suit business hasn't really changed. I mean, obviously, I took a little bit of liberty with the same picture, one in black and white and one in color, but I was recently at a charity event with my old menswear group and all my friends who I used to buy from, and it's the same people with bigger bellies and less hair selling the same products under the same brands today. And there really hasn't been that much movement in most of the key categories that the brick and mortar retailers play in, particularly in the department store world. The most defining moment of my career was when I got what at the time I thought was a death sentence, moving into the cellar at Macy's when all these other housewares retailers that were easier to shop and had great brands were coming up and taking market share. But I started in housewares and I immediately realized that this business was different. And I immediately fell in love. It was the late 90s, and Food Network was gaining prominence in all the cable networks. They were rolling out into most households across America. Chefs, you know, these hardworking guys who were in the kitchen, sweating and slaving over meals, were now coming out of the kitchen and becoming celebrities. And there was a whole host of products to be able to develop. And I was always fascinated with the product side of the business and the innovation side of the business. What was amazing to me and where I saw that this business was really, really different is I had the opportunity to see businesses built out of nothing. I mean, businesses that seem to come out of left field almost overnight. It's never really an overnight story, but the velocity that a new business can gain once they start to get market penetration and get some momentum behind them is incredible. So to see lots of different single-serve coffee solutions fail, and then Keurig, Green Mountain come on the scene with a different way of telling their story, a different way of penetrating the market, and grow into a multi-billion dollar business in really what seemed like overnight, certainly in a few years out. And it gave the retailers something to really hang their hats on. Was always also in awe of the infomercial guys. And this isn't really something that I want to call out in a big way at the Smart Kitchen Summit, because I think it's on the kind of on the other end of the spectrum. But these guys were able to create household names overnight. And that's something that I never experienced in any other industry. And I really would think about this, and I don't sleep a lot, and I think a lot in bed and in the shower, and always thought about how do these companies come out of nowhere, or seemingly come out of nowhere, and gain the kind of prominence that they do. And it came down to really a simple point. Every one of these businesses had two basic ingredients. One is a life-improving innovation. That could be life-improving, like the Snuggie, keeping you warm on the sofa. And it also had a compelling story. And that compelling story was such a critical part of how these companies really came to be. And when you combine those two things, and you look at all the businesses that seemingly came out of left field overnight and grew into $1 billion in sales, revenue growth year over year, it really comes down to something as simple as these two ingredients, sprinkle in a little bit of business acumen, which I take for granted that if you get to the point where you've made it this far, there's enough business acumen that you keep the business going. So I decided in 2010 that the time was right for me, after starting at Macy's with 70 stores, running a $30 million business, leaving Macy's 10 years later as the senior VP of home, running a $2.5 billion business in 700 stores. My world was taken so far away from product and innovation and just dealing with acquisitions and operations that I really wanted to get back to building a company that would leverage knowledge of retail, knowledge of the retail landscape, knowledge of marketing, and help people who were great innovators that may not understand the retail side bring some great products to market. So I started out, and most importantly, and I can't stress this piece enough, I hired a team that was absolutely amazing. I hired retailers from some of the biggest retailers out there because I believed in my core that you needed to have retail knowledge in order to sell to retailers. And I hired a marketing team that came from outside the industry, just as important because in our industry, it was really decades of the same people kind of doing the same things. So we wanted to shake it up out there. We started working with inventors and innovators and developing an innovation pipeline. We launched the Dash digital blender, which was at the time kind of the first prominent blender that combined a computer chip with an amazing blending process that just takes the guesswork out of getting professional results every time. From there, we set out to create and reinvent the iron, steam iron, not overly glamorous, but we knew that there was a better way to make an iron. We licensed the Maytag brand, and since then, we've grown to be the number one consumer-rated iron in the market. From there, we stepped out and we launched the Pancake Bot. And this was one of the most interesting products that we launched. And it was less about believing that 3D food printing needs to come to the kitchen. And it was more about inspiring kids about technology in a way that they would really respond to it, because who doesn't like pancakes? We recently launched the Dash Cold Brew. It's a rapid cold brew system that can make cold brew coffee in 5 minutes. Versus normal process today is, I think, 16 to 24 hours. So time saving for the consumer, big money saving aspect. We're in the process of launching this in the market. And then one of the most fun products that I've been involved in so far is Sobro. And show you a little quick clip on it.
This is the Sobro coffee table. The Sobro is a future of furniture designed for your connected lifestyle. With a refrigerator drawer, Bluetooth speakers, and charging ports, the Sobro keeps you powered up and in the moment.
This one was really exciting because you took things that people need. Charging station. If we stopped there, it probably would have been just as well received. The fact that we added lighting, audio, and a refrigerator was just the icing on the cake. And we've really had a blast for the last 6 years or so launching products into the market, growing like crazy, and for the most part, we've really had our head down, focused on our business, not looking to the external world. There's just not even enough time in the day to do what we're doing today. But there were three different milestones that happened in the last year or so that I wanted to just call out because I think they illustrate some pretty interesting things. So number one is we built a social media following on Instagram that is larger than the entire industry put together. So all 2,800 suppliers at the International Houseware Show, if you combine their Instagram followings, it's smaller than our organic following. And that for us, I put up a slide like this, and I put other brands on it not to embarrass anybody, just as a benchmark to illustrate the point that it doesn't take a heritage brand with brand recognition to build an audience, okay, and to have a voice. We were able to create that by just doing basic 101 content creation, pairing it with the right products, the right messages. And what was beautiful about Instagram at the time that we were building is that you couldn't pay for a following. You couldn't advertise on it. Every follower, over a million followers, actually had to click that follow button and say, I want you in my newsfeed. I want to hear what you're saying on a regular basis. And to me, social media becomes such an amazing levelizer. It's a great leveler for this industry where little companies, smaller companies can still have a voice to the consumer. The other thing that was interesting that happened is somewhere along the way, retailers have this kind of preconceived notion about what's going to resonate with their consumer. And we had one particular meeting with a big box retailer with a national presence, and the buyer sat down and folded their arms and said, I like your products, but I'm not sure that your brand is going to resonate with the consumer. And I was able to take a slide similar to this and say, you know what? I'm not so sure your brand is going to resonate with the consumer. And that gave us this immediate credibility where we can say, we don't think it's going to resonate. It is resonating, and it's resonating more than yours. Our story's resonating more than your story. We were just named to the INC list of the fastest growing companies in America. That was a nice feather in our cap. But most recently, and kind of most eye-opening to us, was we were honored at the NASDAQ as a next great consumer brand. And that in and of itself was amazing. Had the opportunity to present in a room like this to largely investors and a different kind of event. But what was so eye-opening about that event was we presented with 10 companies, so nine other companies presented their story. All nine other companies were building their business on a direct-to-consumer model. We were the only ones building it on a direct-to-retail model and building a system that's really meant to sell not necessarily to the retailer, but through the retailer. So what I think we've found is that with all the turmoil going on in retail today and what the news kind of blows out of proportion, we all see that there are so many retailers out there that are thriving today and that it is possible to thrive in this industry. So we've put together a set of rules, and we have 8 rules that we follow essentially every day in our company. And I think that they're basic rules that everybody in this room can benefit from, whether it's big company, small company, innovator, startup, or you're just considering business today. So So I'll run through them. First one is to be honest. And I'm not talking about honesty to whoever in your life. I'm talking about honesty to yourself. I get inventor after inventor coming to me with a aggressive sales pitch and crazy data. If there's a billion people and we only capture 10% of them, our business will be blah, blah, blah. You know the story. And what we find is that when you peel back what they're saying or what they're inventing or what they're seemingly dedicating their life on, they have not stepped back and said, I need to be honest with myself and say, is there really a consumer demand for this product? So be honest with yourself. Number two, set goals. I had three goals when I started, and they weren't about how much business to do in what year. Goal number one was never to work for another person's large corporation. Number two was to build an amazing world-class team. And number three was to win hearts. Number three, and probably toughest for me, was know what you don't know. Coming out of Macy's running a giant business, I thought I knew business. Then I started a business and realized I don't know anything. So I surrounded myself with people that did. And I was really self-critical and I was honest with myself about what I don't know. Number four is leverage infrastructure. We could have built a social network. We decided to build on a social network. We could have sent out 40 million postcards to announce a new product. We chose to let the retailer do it for us and to have them targeted to their best customers. Number five, be nimble. Can't stress this enough. Nothing is going to go your way. Nothing is going to go the way you plan it. If you feel like things are going the way that they should be going, think of the cartoons where somebody's walking in a field and a piano falls on their head. It's not going to happen, but if you're poised and ready to pivot, you'll be in a great shape to deal with it when things don't go your way. Six is celebrate failure. Thomas Edison said, I have not failed. I've only found 10,000 ways that don't work. Every failure brings you closer to your goal. So you need to fail, you need to celebrate the failure, but then you also need to protect yourself from being in harm's way. And part of protecting yourself from being in harm's way is figuring out how to test. We use a lot of crowdfunding. So you may have seen the $1.5 million that we raised for Sobro. What you probably didn't see is our IoT blender. Everybody told us we needed to take our blender, make it Bluetooth, Wi-Fi, app-enabled. And we developed an amazing system for it, launched it through a crowdfunding campaign, and we're used to success on crowdfunding. When we hit that launch button, we were checking to see if the internet was down. It went on a week. We sold four. Three of the purchasers are sitting right there. They work for me, so I don't think they had a choice. But that, to me, was a failure to celebrate because we saved huge time, huge resources. Stay relevant and stay humble. If you're fortunate enough to get toward the top, at the top, near the top, you need to stay relevant to stay there. That's not an easy thing to do. What's just as important is to stay humble in the process, because I firmly believe that everybody who's eventually at the top also gets their place at the bottom. And if you're doing right and conducting yourself the right way when you're at the top, you'd much rather have people's hands trying to lift you up when you're at the bottom than people's feet trying to keep you down. And then finally, and I think most importantly, is to win hearts. We use every interaction that we have in business, whether it's a meeting, a phone call, or a consumer unboxing one of our products for the first time, as a way to win their heart and a way to win them over. And what we found is that with a focus on this, when you win the hearts of your customers and the consumer, business just happens and business flows. Those are the rules that have worked for us. We're always looking for new products, new product innovations. If you have things that you want to talk to us about, my email's up there, evan@storebound.com. We'd love to hear from you. I'm looking forward to a great event today, and thanks very much for listening.